The story of the electric chair is complicated, improbable, and obscure. Very few Americans know that a dentist spearheaded the drive to make electrocution of condemned criminals the law in New York, and the two titans of the late 19th century industry battled fiercely over the electrical system that was to be used. William Kemmler, the first man to be executed in the electric chair, has passed quietly into history, as has his crime for which he was condemned. To most, the electric chair is merely a fact of life, a means to an end, only notable to the extent which it enters into one's opinion on capital punishment. But its entrance into American justice and culture was notable indeed. Intrigue, treachery, murder, politics, progress, fame. The story of the electric chair has it all. Over its history, America's attitudes towards execution have evolved. From colonial times into the nation's early youth, its punishments were harsh. Those found guilty of more severe crimes were executed publicly, usually by hanging, though burning, beheading, and pressing were not unknown. Other criminals faced such unpleasantness as branding, whipping, or nostril slitting. Even those convicted of minor crimes found their sentences both physically painful and publicly humiliating. For missing church, one might find oneself confined in the stocks in the center of town for a few days. A woman who nagged her husband might have her tongue pierced with a piece of iron, or be forced to wear the branks, a metalhead cage which featured a bit to prevent speech. To modern sensibilities, this type of justice seems almost unimaginably brutal. As America aged and grew, its courts adjust sentences, keeping up with the general sense of enlightenment that swept the country. Minor crimes came to be punished more often with confinement than with humiliation. Military courts adopted the firing squad for their death sentences, and the most savage forms of execution were used less frequently. In the early 19th century, they were replaced with hanging, and over time, the hangings came to occur behind the walls of prisons or jails more often than in the town square. Most people no longer had the stomach for public executions. The general opinion was that justice could be served without bloodthirstiness, and while executions were necessary, they should be carried out as quietly and humanely as possible. Hanging seemed to meet these requirements. Hanging, though, had its problems. The hangman's dilemma was one of physics, how to figure the proper distance for the condemned to drop before the rope pulled tautly and dispatched them. Too short a drop wouldn't generate enough force to break the victim's neck, leaving him to strangle slowly, sometimes for as long as 20 minutes. Too long a drop would generate too much force, which resulted sometimes in unintentional beheadings. The variables in the equation were many: the type of rope, the type of knot, the placement of the knot, and the weight of the condemned all figured in, and it was all too easy to miscalculate and get cruel or gory results. Late 19th century Americans felt strongly that they were living in a modern age. Surely, with all the new wonders of technology, there had to be a quick, humane method to carry out the state's responsibility of executing criminals. Although most people associate electricity with Thomas Edison and the late 19th century, it was harnessed and put to use much earlier by several scientists in various countries. The Leyden jar, a device for storing and discharging static electricity, was invented in 1745. The amount of charge stored in the Leyden jar was enough to kill small animals such as birds, fish, and mice, and its demonstrators did just that to show its capabilities. In 1786, Luigi Galvani posited that electricity was the essence of life. He and others ran charges through dead animals and eventually corpses, reanimating them in frightening ways. What these predecessors of Edison could not do was manipulate electricity in any way that was meaningful to common people. Although Zenobe Theophile Graham had proven in 1873 that electricity could be transmitted from place to place via overhead conductors, the production and control of the voltages necessary to serve society remained theoretical until Edison worked them out. His incandescent light bulb was a practical, universal use to which the science of electricity could be put. His power plants and distribution systems bridged the gap between the scientists in their labs and the common man in his home. Edison built his first power plant in 1879. Almost immediately, representatives from cities around the country were clamoring for contracts to have their cities wired for the new marvel. City after city was illuminated, all using Edison's system, which ran on direct current. Direct current was not without its problems, though. In DC systems, the electricity always flowed in one direction. An extra piece of equipment, the communicator, was necessary to ensure that the flow always went in the proper direction. Hence, DC systems were complicated. Another problem was that the voltages in a DC system dropped off sharply after a relatively short distance. Many power plants would have to be built to supply reliable power to even a medium-sized city. There was an alternative. Nikola Tesla, a bizarre Croatian genius, recognized the problems inherent in DC systems and envisioned a system that ran on alternating current. In AC systems, the electricity changes direction many times a second, creating a magnetic field that allows for the transport of huge voltages without loss along the way. These voltages are then stepped down through transformers to a level that's safe for use by the public. A few cities were wired with early AC systems, not of Tesla's design. Though these were inferior to the systems Tesla imagined, they piqued the interest of a few investors. One of these was George Westinghouse, who had made his first fortune with the invention of the railroad air brake. Westinghouse intended to make alternating current profitable. But for the time being, Edison's direct current was by far the most popular technology. Tesla was employed by Edison for less than a year. During this time, he told Edison of his theories. Edison dismissed them, and Tesla left his employ in frustration. In 1887, he finally secured patents for his system and, more importantly, financial backing. He was now able to demonstrate the theories he had carried in his head for years. Westinghouse took notice. In 1888, he bought 40 patents from Tesla, and within a few years, over 100 cities and towns were wired for Westinghouse AC power. Edison was losing business and employees to Westinghouse, and he was angry. In Buffalo, New York, a dentist named Alfred Southwick kept abreast of the latest developments concerning electricity. As a medical man, he thought electricity could be useful to him in his practice, perhaps as an anesthetic. When a Buffalo man stumbled into a generator at the city's power plant and was electrocuted, Southwick got an idea. Death from exposure to electricity, he thought, was an instantaneous, painless way to die. It could be adopted by the state as a replacement for hanging. At the same time, Dr. George Fell, also of Buffalo, was coming to the same conclusions. After having shared their ideas with each other at a meeting of a Buffalo Scientific Society, Dr. Fells and Southwick went to Colonel Rockwell, the head of the Buffalo Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals. Electrocution, they told Rockwell, was a far more efficient and humane method of disposing of unwanted animals than drowning, which was the method then most often employed. Rockwell agreed. In 1882, Southwick and Fell began a long series of experiments on Buffalo's surplus animals, publishing their findings in scientific papers as they progressed. Southwick had an influential friend in the New York state government, Senator Daniel McMillan. When Southwick showed McMillan the results of his experiments, McMillan was struck by how useful electrocution would be against those who wanted to abolish the death penalty. The main benefit of electrocution was, Southwick claimed, its quick and painless nature. If abolitionists could no longer claim that capital punishment was cruel and painful, then their arguments against it would carry no weight. McMillan, a strong proponent of capital punishment, took Southwick's ideas to Governor David Bennett Hill. Hill was convinced. In his 1885 State of the State message, he charged the New York legislature with finding a means for taking the life of such as are condemned to die in a less barbarous manner. The legislature did not address Hill's concerns in 1885. In 1886, he took a different tack, appointing a commission to investigate and report the most humane and practical method of carrying into effect the sentence of death in capital cases. Appointed to the committee were Alfred Southwick, Matthew Hale, and Elbridge Gerry. The conclusion arrived at their 95-page report was this, that of all the types of execution that could possibly replace hanging, electrocution was the best option. The report, submitted in January of 1886, recommended that New York should adopt electrocution as a replacement for hanging. A proposed bill for the amendment of the Criminal Procedure Code was included. It was introduced in the legislature almost immediately. Public reaction to the bill was mixed, and by spring it seemed doomed, having suffered several amendments that left it a shell of its former self. But on May 8th, the final day of the legislative session, Senator Henry Coggleshell maneuvered the bill back into its original form and got it passed with a voice vote. Such political gymnastics were uncommon, but raised few eyebrows in an era known for greed and graft. Governor Hill signed the bill on June 5th, and it was set to become law on January 1st, 1889. From that point forward, condemned criminals in New York would be electrocuted instead of hanged. What remained to be decided, though, was which system, AC or DC, would be used in the New York death chamber. It was becoming evident that alternating current would eclipse direct current for providing power to towns and cities